All right, everyone, welcome back. Always great to see a full house. And give a warm welcome to Fatih and Blagoy, who will be talking about GitOps and microservices from Bosch.
All right, so we can start. So let's talk a little about GitOps. Sorry, that thing is not working. But yeah, we can switch. Okay, let's talk. Firstly, welcome to our talk, GitOps and microservices in a minute from creation to prod at Bosch Digital. So I'm super happy to see full room. Now we need to prove that, right? Okay, so I'm excited and happy. Also, I hope you will learn something new today here, or at least you will find some new ideas here. So we have a bug with this already, but that's okay. So my name is Blago Netkovski. I am actually a DevOps tech lead in a Bosch Digital in Belgrade office. I have almost 10 years of experience. Let's say the strong background in that ops part, but for the last 5 to 6 years, I mostly work with cloud and DevOps technologies, and let's say I like to automate things. Also, I'm happy to share the stage today here with my colleague from the Germany, from the Stuttgart office, Fatih. So Fatih, welcome. Could you tell something about yourself?
Thank you, Blagoje. Also a warm welcome from my side to the audience. My name is Fatih Salikutluk. I have more than a decade in IT now, strongly background in backend engineering and DevOps. With that saying, I will guide you through the agenda. First of all, we wanted to share with you some goals of our project. No worries, it's not about the project, it's just that give you an overview what we deal with, what requirements do we tackle within our platform, and that's why I just wanted to give you a rough overview about that. Next, I will talk a little bit about what is GitOps at all, so just a quick overview, what does that mean, and then Blagoje will hand over with everything as code. There we will give a more detailed deep dive into our solution and how our platform looks like. And then we are going to do a demo. We will create a brand new microservice with our templates and all of our automation and show you how our pipeline works until that microservice comes to our environment. And last but not least, we will have some time for Q&A, hopefully, yeah. With that said, let me jump into the what is the goal of the project. So first of all, let me share you some stuff we had 2 years ago. We had a couple of mobile applications within our department, and all of them would be evolved to the next step and should get a cloud backend to synchronize data through different devices. On top of those data, we wanted to build some web applications, and for that, you can imagine how that works. All that project started to create a cloud infrastructure, starting to create their own backend applications, mostly Spring Boot. And as you can imagine, as Bosch, we have a lot of compliance regulatories and rules that we need to follow. So all of those applications needs to implement that, those compliance rules to their infrastructure. So you can imagine a lot of repeating work, a lot of same stuff to do over and over again in each of our projects and products. So that's why we came up with the idea to create an internal development platform, which is basically out of the box, delivers to all of those product teams the possibility to use Bosch compliant components like cloud resources and predefined and pre-template Spring Boot and micro front-end services. Only with that today, I mean, that platform is still growing, still improving, today we are able to reduce our cloud costs already to one of the third of its total cost only by sharing cloud infrastructure. we could reduce the operation costs. I mean, you can imagine each team needs to have those DevOps engineers who are maintaining, deploying, monitoring all those infrastructure, right? With the platform, we have one shared infrastructure. We could reduce the costs of DevOps engineers by half. That does not mean that the other guys are now unemployed. I mean, there is a lot to do, right? So don't be afraid about that. And we could reduce the time to market by our templates, right? Because we will show that later in the demo, we created some cookie cutter templates where the dev team can just create a template and start working on business logic. No more Bosch compliant rules, no more security configurations and so on. By that, we could reduce duplications, and especially with those shared microservices, we face that products are re-implementing always the same logic again. So something like user service, company management, right? These are services that are necessary for all of our applications, but they are doing always the same stuff. So we implemented shared microservices. On top of that, we implemented shared micro frontends. So the look and feel is the same, and it is a shared service managed by our platform team. The most critical part and the most benefit that I can see in that is the increasing of the security, because we have a dedicated team which is preparing those templates, which is operating that infrastructure. Always security updates will be in place, and the dev team can have this dev joy and can just implement code, right? With that said, that's the product or the project. And now, what is GitOps? Does anyone in the audience already heard about that or using GitOps by itself in this project? Okay, a couple of them. I will make it kind of quick. What is GitOps? GitOps, it's an approach where you declaratively define the desired state. What does that mean? So these days, mostly we are using Kubernetes, and in Kubernetes, you define what should your application be look like in your desired state, right? You are saying, I want to have this Docker image deployed with two replicas, and then Kubernetes will grab that information and will deploy you exactly that image with two replicas in your desired state, right? And with GitOps, the source of truth is Git. So you push that definition of your desired state into Git, and our operators will take care of this and take the information from Git and will represent that in the desired state. So with that, we have all the advantages of Git included in our system, not only for the applications like we know today. I mean, today we all are using Git, or most of us are using Git. And with that, we have this Git not only for our applications, but also for our infrastructure, because we also define the infrastructure in Git. We have versioning, rollbacks, and so on, so all the benefits that Git gives to us. Our key benefits are we have everything defined as code. We have Git flow, not only for applications, instead also for our infrastructure. All changes are documented in Git, and the most critical and the most beneficial thing is no developer or no operator or DevOps engineer needs to have access to those infrastructure. They are fully managed by GitOps. So Git is the state that we define, and it will represent it in the infrastructure. No one needs to access the infrastructure itself. So how does that work? A quick overview. As I mentioned, we have this platform built up. The management cluster here on the middle of the screen is the cluster that is doing all of our GitOps. So it runs our operators. Those operators are the tools that are listening to our Git repositories, figured out what is defined there, if there are any changes. So this will make a pull every 3 minutes. And after it finds any changes, it represents it in the desired state. So this is the Argo CD. Argo CD is basically the communication between our repos and our managing cluster. And this is also operates all of our applications on our Kubernetes. Then in the Git repository, there is all of our stages are represented there. So we have production with blue-green deployment, we have QA with blue-green deployment, and we have a dev cluster for our internal development. We also have a sandbox environment, which each developer can deploy and destroy how it wants, but these are the most critical ones. And the managing cluster is operating all of that. The Atlas MongoDB we are using as the default database for our solutions. And with that, we can define in our Git repository our MongoDBs, our collections, our users, their passwords, and so on. So passwords are not stored in Git. They are stored in Key Vault. And through the CSI driver, we can accept them. With that said, I will hand over to Blagoje with everything as code.
Okay, thank you. So let's continue. So when we look on that world, everything as code, everything as code, like always as code, but in this case, the reason why we choose to put everything is as code is actually because we do more than 80% of our work through code, but also we deploy 100% of our resources through code. So in this chapter, so I will follow up on a Fatih discussion about project goals. So let's emphasize just four of them. We have much more, but for this discussion, let's just emphasize four. So Fatih mentioned reducing operational costs. Definitely, we achieved that with the platform. So currently, we are able with just three DevOps team members to maintain actually the whole platform. That is very important. Also, the second benefit is about time to market, how to reduce, right? Time to market is always critical since our success depends on that. We are living in that era, but important thing is how we do that. We do that through standardization. What that actually means, mean that we integrate. Fatih also mentioned the cookie cutter template. So we try to actually use template as code whenever we can use that. So you will see later on more about this in a demo we prepared. But actually, we do a template as a code for all the security checks, for all compliance, for a lot more. You will see actually the Sonar Cube, Chekhov, and stuff like that. Then directly, that standardization is connected with the freedom to the platform users, but as well for to increasing developer experience. When we talk about the freedom to the platform users, that is actually the important part of our platform. So we, at the beginning, decided that we really want to give a chance to our users or clients to develop independently out of that. Only one important thing here is single point of truth. So let's finish on the Git and we then deploy or work on that. Also, when we are talking about increasing developer experience, that is also an important topic we need to cover since every developer actually wants to fully focus on development of code, not on, I don't know, building of Docker image or something like that. So we also achieve that using the platform. So developer actually easily in like 5 to 10 minutes can create a new service and then just fully focus to development of code base. Okay, so how we achieve that? Actually, which tools we are using. Here is just a short and small list of the services. Definitely, we don't have time to cover all of those tools, but I want to mention just some of those. Actually, the question, maybe the interesting one is Chekhov and Dependabot. So does anyone try to use those tools? Yeah, that's nice. Not more people use, but definitely I recommend to try to investigate firstly and then to easily integrate because those tools are like lightweight and you can easily integrate it in your pipelines. So when we are talking about the Chekhov, that tool actually will help you with checking of your misconfigurations for your Docker files, Helm files. Also, you can check the Kubernetes files, so all deployment files. Beside that, also infrastructure as a code, like Terraform, ARM templates, and others. When we are talking about the PandaBot, that one actually is about automated dependency updates through pull requests. So I know I am pretty much sure that you all know, for example, for that log4j vulnerability. So in that case, actually, PandaBot will just suggest you an update. So actually, PandaBot fix and vulnerability. So you just need to approve, right? Okay, let's just a few more words about Pulumi, because that is maybe not a tool more people use these days, but that is actually a tool same like Terraform, so infrastructure as a code tool. The one key benefit here, and maybe interesting for backend developers, is that we actually build the whole infrastructure or platform on TypeScript. So because of that, we decide to use Pulumi. Okay. So now a little bigger picture. So I will try to go through the process of CI/CD and how we actually build the flow. But let's, before I do that, just a couple more insight about infrastructure. So you see here actually those icons for the Kubernetes. So we already mentioned that we have the blue-green deployment, because that is kind of necessary for the big platforms, but also two important things also I suggest to integrate if you didn't have a chance to use is node automatic scaling on Kubernetes. That is the thing we integrate, and also horizontal pod auto-scaling. So that auto-scaler for the pod you can use in combination with Datadog. So that actually really helps us, because platform is growing. So in that case, we are, let's say, free to go in that way, right? Okay, then let's start with CI/CD workflow. So at the beginning, we have a developer who push a code and trigger a pipeline. Then we have that CI part. You have, you see that box. Actually, on this picture, we didn't put all the possibilities for the test, but actually that CI part contains all the security checks, compliance checks, predefined tests. So you see here the Sonar Cube, but beside the Sonar Cube, we provide an options to clients to choose whenever they want. That is actually the check of dependency track and stuff like that. Also in that part, we have Docker build and push. So after build, image is pushed to container registry. In our case, that is Azure, because we are decided at the beginning to be fully on Azure. Then in that CI pipeline, we have the script, which actually updates in, as we mentioned, single point of truth, in this case, Azure repos. So the thing I want to mention now, so here we have actually different environments, so we will follow this one for the QA. So here we have actually an app of apps on Argo CD, which actually constantly listen to any change to that single point of truth. So after Argo CD notice any change, actually start updating of all the application inside the Argo CD. And after sync, all of this actually update on Kubernetes, then trigger the post sync, which actually trigger another pipeline. That pipeline actually is end-to-end testing, automated end-to-end testing. So after those tests passed, the another script actually update again the single point of truth, right? The same repo but different folder, you will see in the demo, and then actually the same thing, right? And that's pretty much it, all about the flow of our CD. So you will see more about code in a demo.
So. All right. Thank you very much. So I will jump into our demo that we prepared. So as I promised, we are going to create a brand new microservice. I mean, I never do live coding on stage. That's why we recorded that stuff. We will start by our cookie cutter template. As you can see, we decided to use the Kafka Rich template. This is one of our templates, which is including Kafka consumers and Kafka producers, because we heavily use those internal communications through Kafka. And as you can see, I define an output folder under services. And basically with those commands, the Spring Boot template is already created. I can open this in IntelliJ. It looks like this. As you can see, we already have our Helm charts generated out of the box with all those ingress configuration, config maps. We have three demo REST endpoints with post get mappings two times, and one of is the hello world, just to check that the application is there. And we have the layer architecture already implemented. As you can see, we have REST service and repository layer already. They are already included to those to all of those codes that is created. We have tests already included, so that the developer really just needs to replace that template code with his business logic, and already tests are there, and tests needs to be adapted to the code. As already said, I mean, security is included. We have the Docker file. You can see that Datadog agent is already configured properly. So if the developer just decided to deploy this into our pipeline, this will work out of the box. We'll have SonarQube integration. We can see it here. So we have our release pipeline defined. So here you can see it is pointing to one of our templates where the code is built and analysis. Then we have the SBOM generation, we have Docker built and push, and we have those security checks with checkoff, etc. And then we have the push config, which is basically updating the desired state of this application to be readable to Argo CD. So let's go. I mean, I just recorded also that we have the feature branch method, so we cannot push directly to master to not break things. So as you can see, the output folder is correct. So these are all the files that are generated out of the box for us. I mean, there are a lot, but yeah, this is kind of how Spring Boot works. And as you can see, we have a lot of tests written already, which will also be run in a second in the pipeline. So that is something that we still do manually, the pipeline configuration. Maybe you know about Jenkins. Jenkins can find those Jenkins pipeline files automatically. Azure DevOps cannot do that currently. Hopefully they will update this so that we do not need to do that manually anymore. So I need to say the pipeline where the pipeline file is, and then it will trigger the pipeline. As you can see, that's exactly the same pipeline that I showed to you a minute ago. And now we need to tell Argo CD where to find those applications. And this is what we are doing in our CraftSphere config repository here. You can see we have different environments as previously shown to you. We have our dev environment, therefore we have the dev service, I mean, under the folder dev services heap con service, prod blue, prod green, QA blue, and QA green. And we just need to push those automatically created files. I will show you one of those files, at least for this service, how this looks like. Maybe go here. as Blagoj already mentioned, we have this app of apps pattern. That means we have one application file. So this is a custom resource from Kubernetes, which is pointing to this Git repository, which is the Craftsphere config repository that we saw. And it is having the path dev services. So any service that I define and push into this folder dev services will be automatically recognized by Argo CD and will be pushed to the desired environment. So the Heapcon service application is basically looking like this. I again defined that it's the kind of Argo CD application, and here we can see it's pointing to another Git repository where basically the Helm file is there. So I already showed to you that service heapcon service chart. There is my Helm chart defined, which Kubernetes needs to deploy that application, right? And here we are using the dev values because we are on dev, and this image tag will be just updated by the push config in our pipeline. So let me go back here. We push this, and with that, Argo CD will recognize that this application is new and needs to be deployed. Since our template also offers a connection to MongoDB, we have another repository, which is our DevOps config repository. So we split that up a little bit in application repository, application config repository, and our DevOps repository. And here we can see we out of the box get this Heapcon DB user with some configuration for the CSI driver to grab the user's password from Key Vault and not from Git. So this will be deployed, this will be pushed to Git, and then again will be recognized by Argo CD automatically. This will deploy into our managing cluster that user's Kubernetes object, and this will then be grabbed by the Mongo operator to deploy it into our Atlas MongoDB. Basically, with that Git push, we can see this is the Atlas MongoDB. Here on Argo CD, we can see there is this, I hope you can read that, this is the Heapcon service user, and we have the Heapcon service user production, which is basically two different environments, right? So we have the user for dev and QA sharing the same environment, and we have a production environment where we have just a separate instance for it. The config file looks like this. Maybe that was a bit too fast. So we can see that here in this file we have this Heapcon service user that was just represented in Argo CD and is represented in the cluster. We have the prod user, and we are having roles even defined in that file so that this Heapcon user only have access to his own database and not to all databases. And as you can see, we have a reference to his secret, which is not in Git because that would be not security wise good to do. And as you can see, the user is already deployed through those operators automatically. So no one needs to go to Atlas MongoDB, create that user, and need to interact with the system. Just Git push and everything will be generated for you out of the box. So non-developer needs to have access to the system. Now let's have a look into the Heapcon service. So as you can see, we have it now represented for all environments in our Argo system, Argo CD system, just by pushing that config into our Git repository. Let's have a look. As you can see, all the Kubernetes objects that are represented in our Git repository will be represented also in Argo CD and will also be part of our system, our dev environment in this case. So you can see there we have this config map, we have service account, we have the pod autoscaler out of the box in place, we have those different ingress routers that we need, and basically we are good to go to call our service. This is what's coming next. So here you can see it's an error, but it's an error that we would predict, right? Because it's a 401. As I showed to you, we have security out of the box. So without a valid token, you cannot access that API. So I'm going to add a valid Bira token to it, refresh the page, and we can see hello world from Heapcon service. So basically that's it. And if we want to do this on QA, we would need to git tag, create a git tag with an RC minus in front, and this will trigger the QA pipeline. And if we want to deploy this to our prod, we just make out of the release candidate git tag, release git tag, and with that, it will be automatically deployed to our production green environment, which is our test environment. And after, let's say, the product owner defines, okay, this is going to be real on production, he can just trigger a button which will deploy that in QA blue. With that, thank you very much. Now we have 5 more minutes. At least 5 more minutes for Q&A. We were time management wise perfectly, right?
Hello, I'm Branko. And my take is, what is your take on Pulumi and Drift experience? Do you have some issues, problems? Or
yeah, so definitely the initial setup was kind of a little bit hard. But basically, it's kind of working same like Terraform, and it is super developer comfortable because, I mean, they evolve with those programming language. You can even create your infrastructure in Java now. So, I mean, you can do it in TypeScript, Java, and there are several other languages that they are supporting. And after the initial setup, it's super easy to use for us. Yeah.
You know me.
I know you.
So, how much time did you need to get to this state of having everything as code?
I mean, this took us at least 1 year or a little bit more than 1 year to set up that platform that you can see now. I mean, we really started even with those operators that we are using, which were in alpha state. So we also had some git commands, find some bugs, creating some kind of stuff like this. Azure DevOps was kind of sometimes a blocker because some of those operators did not work out of the box with that. But yeah, around 1 year, but I'm pretty sure if someone would start with that now, could be faster.
Yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome. There was another question. So we have that, basically. We have Helm with different values for the environment. For us, it was more about the processes that we have within Bosch. So pushing something to production is not allowed just by automation. So you need to have some QGs, so quality gates that you need to fulfill. You need to have some documents pre-prepared. So the process is slowing us a little bit in the tech. We could do that easily out of the box to commit and then deploy to the desired state, but the process does not allow this currently, and that's why it's also, let's say, a benefit internally to have this internal development platform, which is which is kind of aligned to the processes that you need to fulfill, right? So what we have, I mean, Blagoje shared this after on QA Green, we are triggering our end-to-end tests. Those end-to-end test results are reflected to Jira and document there the test runs, if the tests were failing, if the tests were passing. And this then again will grab by the QA team, and then this quality gate document will create it out of that. Yeah, it's more a process thing.
Okay, we have two more minutes for questions, and luckily we have questions on Huva. So here we go. From our online attendees, do you use a single shared dev environment on Azure, or you have dev env per developer? If first is the case, how do you manage deployment collisions during development of different features?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I mentioned that in the presentation quickly. We have this setup with one click. Each developer can create his own Kubernetes cluster, which is kind of the same like the dev cluster. So each developer can deploy whatever he wants or she wants and can break the system as she wants. Click on a button, it's gone, and can recreate. So there will be no collision at all during dev. And our master branch or main branch is the branch that is always deploying to dev, just for testing for dev people.
All right, I understand.
That's good.
How monitoring and observability is handled to ensure system health?
So we have Datadog integration. There we have the semantic tests, which are pinging our health endpoint from each of our services. As I showed in the template, it is out of the box integration. So it's monitoring, observing. We even have notifications on team if a service is down on Argo CD, or Datadog monitors any issues like services down for more than a second or 10 seconds.
Just one addition. I also mentioned the Datadog. That is also one benefit for using the Datadog. So we are using Datadog for also horizontal pod auto scaling. You can set by the metrics. Actually, you can collect the metrics and then configure the pod auto scaling.
All right, that's all the time we have right now. See you guys back in 10 minutes for Java's new paradigm. And thank you too for a wonderful talk.
Thank you.